Managing network in our Linux system. Managing network, we have different tools available for managing it. We can manage it from graphical. We can use this graphical tool. We can go to turn off the device. We can go to the wired setting and we can manage it from here. We can manage it from here. We have wired option. We can go on to select the configuration and we can change these configuration. We can manage these identity. We can manage the IPv4 addresses. We can manage these and these things, and we can enable and disable the interface from here also. If you want to enable disable, then we can do what? We can just click here to disable the interface, and to enable the interface we can do it from here. Now this is what the graphical option we have. Now if you want to do it from the command line, then we can use the command nmcli. We can use a command nmcli to do this, to disable or enable the interface. First, we have to make sure, we have to understand that we have two things here. We have a profile here, and then we have a device. Device is a physical thing, and profiles is a virtual thing. So virtually, we can have multiple profiles, but the device will remain single. So in different profiles, we can have different configurations of IP address also, but only one profile will be attached to this physical interface. Like here it is attached, this profile here with this physical device. Now if suppose you want to shut, you want to disable the interface, so if you want to disable it, so when you want to disable the interface, so it is a good idea to disable the device, not the profile. Because if suppose we disable one profile, maybe there is another profile, so your device will still keep running by using the other profile. So when we disable the profile, we want to disable the interface, so we have to disable the device. So what we do, we run the command nmcli. So we have to mention nmcli device disconnect and then the device name. Now this command will do what? It will disconnect the device. Now device disconnect means it is going to disable our interface. And if we, is it a, it's a graphical, so you can see here the network port is not showing here. Now when we want to enable the interface, then it is a good idea to enable the profile, not the device. Because we want to make sure that which profile we want to enable, because maybe we have multiple profiles and maybe we have different profiles with different configurations. So we want to enable which profile, we should decide. So when we want to enable the device, so we should enable the profile. So that profile will be enabled, with that profile the device will also be enabled. So we will run the nmcli connection up and then the connection name, that means the connection profile, and this will do what? It will enable the profile with the device, and we can see the interface is available here. So this is what disabling and enabling the interface. And if we want to see the information about the interface, then what we can do, we can have another tool, it is called ETH tool we have, with the interface name. So it will show you the information about the interface also, like it supported the port TP, twisted pair, this is the supported link, we have supported, it is a pause frame, use or not, supports auto negotiation, yes, advertised link mode is this, and speed is this, duplex is full, port is twisted pair, transceiver is internal, auto negotiation is on, these, all these things. And also it is saying here that the physical link is, yes, it is detected. Sometime what happened, if suppose the port is disconnected from, physically it is connected, removed from the port, from the network adapter, the network port, the network cable. Then what? In command line we will not be able to see this. If here in this graphical we can see the interface will be, say here, the interface will be disconnected, it will show here. But in command line it will not show it like graphical. So you don't know that the cable is removed from the port. You will see when you run this command, if it says the link detected yes, that means our cable is connected to the port. If the port is removed, then what? You will say no, the port is not connected. For example, I will remove the port from the machine. Now when you run, after removing the cable, when you run this command, it shows this information, but it is not showing what the speed is not showing because the cable is not connected, and also it is saying that link detected no. That means it is not able to detect the link. So when you connect the link back, then it will connect here. It will show the link is connected. Now the link is connected again, and now when you check, it shows this speed is also showing here, duplex speed, and also now it is showing that link is detected yes. Then for managing network, we have different tools. So for example, we have ping. Now ping command is used to check the connectivity. If you want to check our machine is connected to the network, connected to the other machines or not, then we can use the ping command. For example, I want to check my machine is connected to the other system or not. We have another system called Linux 2, and the machine is having the IP address of 19.0.0.2. So when I check this, now I'm getting the reply from here. I'm getting the reply. Now what the ping do? It actually sends the echo request packet to this for this IP address, and it will go to everywhere in the network. Now if suppose the machine is not connected in the same network, then what? You will not get the reply. So if the machine is there with this IP address, it will send the reply, and it will show like this. So this is the reply we are getting from this IP address. Now in Windows system, when we do this, it will send only 4 packets. But here under the Linux system, when you do this, it will send continuously packet. It will send continuous packet, and also you will see the difference is this TTL value. In Windows, you will get 128 as a TTL value, and here you will see 64 as a TTL value. So this is what it is continuously pinging, and we want to stop it, then we have to press Ctrl C. So because we are connected, we are getting the reply. If you want to do it with other options, so ping has other options also available to use. Like for example, when you run the help, you have the different options available. Like you want to send how many packets, you want to send between how many intervals, and if you have multiple interfaces, then you can select which interface you want to send the data, you want to send the ping request. And the other options are also there, like we can change the TTL value. We can change with the timeout also, timeout to wait for the reply. Then also we can change the packet size. By default it is sending the 64 bit size of the package, so we can change these multiple options from here. Now for example, it is sending continuously pinging packets. It sends continuously echo packets. I don't want to send continue, so I will say I want to send only 4 packets. See, for count with this IP address, and now it will send only 4 packets. Then other options like this, you can see send the change the packet size with S option. You can change the TTL value. Right now by default it is 64. We can change the time it waits to get the reply, that without a timeout. That means it waits that how much time, first it sends the echo request, and then it will wait for the how much time it will wait to get the reply. So we can change that time also. The interval also we can change, that one packet it sends, then how much time after that it will send the second packet. We can change the interfaces also. So this is what ping. Ping is what to do the checking the connectivity. If suppose we are not connected to some system, if suppose I give an IP address which is not available in our network, so what it will do, it will send this destination host unreachable. It is saying that our own machine, it is getting the reply from our own machine, and is saying destination host is unreachable. Then after the ping, suppose we are not getting the reply, then what we can do, we can use the trace route. We can use the trace route command to trace the route. It will trace the route from source machine to the destination machine. Source machine is our machine and destination is the machine which we want to check the path. So it will check how many routers are coming in between, that means how many hops are coming, and if suppose we are not reaching the destination, so where the packets are dropping. Right now we are just in the same network, so there is no router which is connecting this source machine to this destination machine. So we can see it is reached after only one hop. But if we have multiple hops there, then we can see those hops also by using this. This is a helpful command to see if suppose we are getting timeout and we are not getting the reply. So this is a helpful command to see that where our packets are exactly dropping. Then another command we have, which is called netstate. Netstate command is to check how many network services we are running here. That means our system is listening on how many services. That means suppose we configure the system for a web server. For example, we configure the server for web server. This server as a web server. So when the web server, we configure the web server, so web services will be started here, and our system web servers are runs on protocol HTTP, and HTTP protocol uses the port number 80. So if we configure the web server, so web services will be configured here, and our system, our web server, will be start listening on port number 80 for any request for our web services. So we want to see that our system is listening on how many services or how many port numbers. So we can run this command. When you run the netstate, it will run a whole information in detail here. It is unfiltered detail, which shows multiple connected or streams. Now, if we want to do the filtering, so what we can do, we can use the options. Like for example, I want to see only TCP services. So I will use T. Then I want to see TCP. I want to see only TCP services. I want to see the programs which is running with that TCP protocol services, TCP services that with the protocol. Then I want to see which protocols or which services our system is listening. L for listening. So when I run this, it shows like this. It shows that our system is listening on these TCP services, TCP for IPv4 and TCP for IPv6. So this is what the local address, this is the address for our local system, and this is what the service name. This is domain. Now domain means actually it is DNS. It is DNS. And then we have SSH also. And for SSH, our system is listening on all the IP addresses. Then we have the services for IPP protocol, SMTP for mailing. Then again for IPv6, we have SSH, IPP or SMTP. This is the local IP addresses and this is the foreign addresses. That means, for example, this is the local address. So our system is listening for this on this IP addresses. From this, for this DNS services, and it is accepting any foreign address. That means if connection request is coming from any foreign address, so it will accept this address for DNS. But the address is it will accept the request only for this address. That means for the destination, like when the client, when anyone try to send the request for DNS, it has to send it on this address, otherwise it will not accept it. Now this address is not our address. Our address is 19.0.0.1. This address is coming from the virtual interface, that is virtual bridge interface. It is configured on virtual bridge interface, and that is virtual. Now when you have this 0.0.0.0 for SSH, that means it will accept SSH request for any IP addresses. That means if anyone sends a request to our system for any IP addresses and from any IP addresses, then it will accept the request. It will accept the request for SSH. Now these are local hosts. Now local host means it is only accepting the request for local IP, that is 127.0.0.1. That means it will only accept this, suppose this SMTP. So if suppose someone send the request of SMTP to our machine, so it will not accept that request, because it is not accepting the request for any IP, it is only accepting the request for the loopback interface. So if the request comes for the loopback IP, that is 127.0.0.1, only then it will accept, otherwise it will not accept. Then these are all listening ports, because we have mentioned the L, which is important. It is we have mentioned the P also, so it is showing the program which is running these services with the PID also. That is, DNS is running by this DNS MSAQ, and then this is SSH D daemon, which is running this SSH. Then this is CUPS D, that is this is actually common Unix printer service, and this is the master service for the SMTP. Then these are same for IPv6. Now if you don't want to resolve the name, you just maybe sometime resolving the name can take a time, so we can do what, we can add here an option also. Now this will do what, it will not try to resolve the name. If it is domain, then if it is a 50, if it is a 53 port, then it will not try to resolve the name for the port, it will directly show the port number. So when you run this, so you can see instead of domain, it is showing the port number for the domain, that is 53, it is for DNS. And for SSH, it is not trying to resolve the name, it is directly showing the port number, that is 22. And for again this 127.0.0.1, it is not resolving it, it is directly showing what, 127, it is not showing local host here. Same as for the mail service SMTP, it is directly showing what, 25 here for the mail services. Now these are TCP services. If you want to listen, if you want to see which services, which UDP services our system is listening, so instead of T, we will give U here. And it shows here that these are the UDP services our systems, our system is listening on. This is again for DNS queries, and this is for the DHCP. This is for the DHCP client side, and this is the IPv6. This is for 53. This is Hawaii daemon. This is for the other port here. So these are the services we have, UDP and TCP services, which our system is listening. It is important to see that our system is listening on which ports. Then, now we saw that our system is listening on SSH. That SSH is actually secure shell. It is used to do the remote configuration or remote connection. Remote connection for the remote server, and it do it securely. That means if we are sitting on other room or other side of the network, and our server is kept into the other side, and it is kept into the other room or other floor or somewhere else, and we can connect the server, we can ping the server, we know that the connectivity is there, then we can do what, instead of going into the server directly, we can use the remote connection to configure the server. So if suppose we want to configure something on that, so we can do use the SSH remote connection to get the connection of the server, and then start configuring the server from the client. We don't have to go to server, we don't have to log into the server to configure it. Basically, in our organizations for security, we keep the servers in a secure locked places, in a room where it is not allowed anyone to go into that room. Only the authorized persons goes there. So administrators, if they themselves don't go to those rooms regularly, if they want to do some configuration, so they take the remote connection and they do the configurations. Now for taking the remote connection, we have another option, which is Telnet. But Telnet is not secure. Telnet is not secure because when we use Telnet and we send any commands or anything from by using the Telnet, that is not secure, and that is why we have SSH in Linux. So in Linux we have option to use SSH, and by default SSH is installed and enabled. And in Windows environment, there is no SSH. Actually, in Windows, we are not able to use SSH. We can only use the SSH client, but we can't use SSH server, it's not there. it is we are having it on Linux systems. It is already installed and configured, so we can use the SSH to connect to the server by using the client server architecture. It uses the client server architecture. That means server will be the server who is serving the SSH connection, and the client will use the SSH client tool to connect the SSH server and connect that and connect to get what, to get the remote shell. And that is why it is called SSH, that is SSH, the secure shell. Now remote shell, that means it will get the command line shell, but it is get it securely. Securely, that means whatever the data communication we do, it all will be done in a secure environment. That means the connection will be secured from server, from client to server and server to client. If anyone try to get the data in the middle, they will not be able to see anything, because everything will be encrypted. Now it is already installed, and in case if it is not installed, then what we should do, we can install the package OpenSSH. OpenSSH, when we install a package group OpenSSH, it will come with the multiple other tools also. It will give other tools also which we can use to do the secure connection. Just like we have SSH, we have SCP, we have TFT, STFT, SFTP also. So we have other tools also to do the secure connection. So all of those tools are part of the OpenSSH tool set. So for we have configured the YUM, so we can check OpenSSH package which we need. So in case if it is not installed, right now we can say that it is already installed. This is the OpenSSH package. For the configuration of OpenSSH, it will provide multiple different tools. Then we have the OpenSSH client. It provides the client tools, and this is for OpenSSH server, to configure the server. Now server, that means who is going to serve the connection, and client who is going to use the connection. So clients will, in this package, we have multiple client tools available. Now it is by default installed in every Linux system, and in case if it is not installed, then you should install this. Now after installing, what we can do, we can connect the system from remotely. Now this is our Linux system, Linux 1. I will go to Linux 2 and try to connect the Linux 1. Now this is Linux 2, and I want to connect the Linux 1 from here. So what I can do, I can use the command SSH. Now this command is also a part of OpenSSH toolset. So this command is coming from OpenSSH client package. So when you have installed the client package, you will get this command. So when you run this command to connect the remote server, so I want to connect 19.0.0.1. This is the IP address of the Linux 1. Now if you have configured the DNS services, and we can resolve the name, then what we can do, connect the server by using the name also, but I will use the IP address right now. Now when you connect, connect first time the server, so what you get here, you get this message. Now what this message said, it says the authenticity of the host 19.0.0.1 can't be established. That means our machine don't know anything about this 19.0.0.1 machine. The IP address, this IP address machine, that is Linux 1, it does not know anything about it. Why? Because it is sending this fingerprint key. It is sending this fingerprint key for integrity. Integrity, and also it is sending the public key for doing the encryption from server to this client. So it is sending this key here for integrity, and when you accept this, it will also give you a public key for doing the encryption from this client to the server. So after that, when you send any data, it will be encrypted by using that key, and the server, the other machine, will decrypt it by using their own private private key. Now this fingerprint key is to manage the integrity. So this fingerprint key does not known by our system. So it is saying, I don't know this machine, I don't know this key, what should I do? Because maybe a first time it is doing the communication with this. So this fingerprint key will establish the integrity. So next time, it is saying here, are you sure you want to continue the connecting this? I know I am doing this, so I will say yes. Now this time what it will do, okay, I have taken a too much time here, so it is lost the connection. Now what it do here, it added this information, this key, this fingerprint key with this IP address. It added it into my system. So warning, it says permanently added this IP address key to the list of known host. Now our system knows that this machine, that means this IP address is for this key, and this key means this IP address. Now this, by using this, it manages the integrity. Integrity, that means if suppose next time someone changes the IP address, someone spoofs the IP address of this 19.001, and then it will try to connect me, or I will try to connect the fake machine, then it will not match the key. Definitely it will not match the key. And when it is not matching the key, like if someone is having the if someone has changed the IP address to this one 19.001, and when I try to connect it, like suppose other fake machine, like someone hacker is doing the man in the middle, it is trying to hijack my session, and when I try to connect this original Linux to Linux One server, it is taking my traffic to the fake Linux One server with this IP address. So what happened? The fingerprint key will not match, and we will get the message here that the fingerprint key is not matching. Maybe someone is trying to spoof your connection. It may be the attack. It will give you the message like that. It will say that someone is trying to hack into it. So you know that someone is trying to spoof the address, so you will not do the connection. So now it is permanently added, but I have taken a long time, so connection is loose, it is closed. Now I will do it again, but this time it will not ask that this about the key, because it is already saved. So now this time it is not asking about the key. Key is already saved in my local host, in my local system as a known host. Now it is asking for the password of root user. Because we have not mentioned any username here, so it is going to connect as a root user. So root user password I will give. And now I have connected as a root on this Linux One. Now I have connected as a root, that means I can do anything what root user can do. And I can do anything on that system from here remotely. So this is what the remote shell we are getting. Now how we are getting the remote shell, we are getting through the SSH, and it is the secure shell. So it do what? It manages the integrity of the connection also by using the fingerprint key, and with the fingerprint key it also get the public key of the remote server, so that when you send any data, like when I type the password here, so that password is also sent in encrypted. It encrypted the password with the public key and send it to the server, and that server decrypted the password by using the public private key of itself. And then the communication, whatever the command I will run here, it is going to send the command remotely, securely to the remote server. Now I have logged in as a root. I want to disconnect from here. I have logged in as a root, so root user can do anything. Now if suppose I'm a normal user, I wanted to log in as a normal user on server, that means everyone will not get the root account. Root account will be for the administrator. But if suppose you are having a second administrator account, third administrator account, you want to do something on the server, so you can log in with your user account by using the SSH. So we have some account, we have an account on the server, this Linux One. So I can use that account to log in from here. I have an account there, user 1, user 2, user 3, user 4. So I will try to log in with those accounts. So how I will do that? I will do it by using SSH, then the username, @, and then the machine name or IP address of that system. Now I will put the password of that user. It is asking the password for user 1. And then enter. Now I logged in as a user 1, that is a normal user there. So we can do what this user 1 can do. So this is what we are doing. We are using the SSH as a client server. So from this machine we are using it as a client, and the Linux one is our server. So we are logging in on the server by using the user accounts. User accounts, user 1, user 2, user 3, whatever. Like I want to log in as a user 2 now. So I will mention user 2 here. I will provide the password and then I can log in as a user 2. Now it is not asking me the key, because the key, integrity key, is already saved here. Now where did it save the integrity key? The key will be saved under the home directory of the user who is trying to log in. Now I try to log in as a root here. I have logged in as a root here, and on that account I try to connect the server. So when the key comes, it is stored into my user account, this user account. So in this user account, that means in the profile, in the home directory of this user, it creates this hidden directory called .ssh. And under that .ssh, you have one file that is called known host. And in this known host file, it stores all the integrity keys or different machines which we do the SSH connection. So if you want to see the key, known host, so this is the key we have here. This is the name, this is the IP address or name of the system, this is the type of the key, and this is the key we have. Now if I remove this key and save the file again, that means now we don't have the key now. Now when I try to connect again, it asks me, it says it is not moving the connection, it can't be established because it is a new user. So you want to save the key, you say yes, and then now again it is saved into my file. So this is how the key stores, this is where the key stores. Now till now what we are doing, we are using this Linux 2 as a client and Linux 1 as a server. But in every Linux system, the SSH is already installed by default. So when you check here, netstate-ntpl, so it shows that this is also running SSH. So we can do the two-way connection. That means from the Linux 1, I can connect Linux 2 also, and from Linux 2, I can connect Linux 1 also. So both will work like a server client, so that we can take the remote connection of every machine from every machine. Now if we want to change some settings for our SSH, so we can change it from the configuration file. Now this is our Linux 1, and we are assuming that this is our server. So what we can do, we can change the configuration from the configuration file, which is under etc, under SSH directory, we have the configuration files here. And that is what sshd-config. So when you open this file, you will see the different configuration options here. Now remember, any configuration file starts with, in any configuration file, when the line starts with the hash, it is comment. It is comment, that means these are only comments, and these are some configurations which is not implying, it is not applying, it is only commented here. For example, this configuration here, it is saying port number 22. This is by default port number 22. But if you want to change the port number 22 to any other port, this port number is for SSH protocol. If you want to change the port number to something else, then we can enable the line. That means we just remove the hash and then we can change the port number what we want. And you can see it is listening by default on all IP address, IPv4, IPv4 and IPv6. If you want to change the listening IP, then you can also change it by just disabling this, removing this hash, enabling the configuration line, and then you can add this. And this is the host key. It is stored here under this file. The key which it sends when someone try to connect this machine, so the key is here, which key it sends to the other machine. This is what the integrity key. Then also it has the public key here. Then these are the other options. Now remember, some options are not enabled, but that does not mean the option is not there. The options are still there, and these options are in still default configurations. Like for example, it is saying server key bits. the bit size is 1024, but the line is not enabled. That does not mean the line is the configuration is not there. The configuration is still there, and it is in the default state. And the default state, it is actually 1024 bit. So it is indicating that the default configuration is this, but it is saying that if you want to change, then you can change it by enabling it. Sometimes the lines are not there in the configuration file, but still the configuration are there. This is a syslog facility, authprev, which do the logging for this SSH connections. Then we have the option for authentication, login grace time. That means if you don't do anything in 2 minutes, then it will automatically log out. Then we have option here to permit root login, yes or not. Now this is also, you say it is saying yes, that means root user is permitted to login. That means we can login with SSH remotely by using the root account. Now in Linux, you will see that most of the services will not allow the root user to login. Will not allow the root user to login from remotely. Why? Because remotely login with the root user account is not secure. Because when you login with the root account with the remote machine, and the account username and password will go through the wire, through the network, and it reaches the server. Now in case if someone do the man in the middle attack, then they can see the username and password of root user. And if suppose your root user is compromised, that means your whole system, your whole server can be compromised. So it is not allowed. Root user is never allowed remotely. You can't log in with the remotely, you can't log in with root account in most of the services. But SSH by default, it permits it. Why it permits? Because it is secure. It do the encryption, secure communication. So it allow root user to log in. And remember, telnet is not secure. If suppose if we configure the telnet here, by default it is not configured. But if suppose you configure telnet in Linux, so root users are not allowed to log in with telnet. You cannot log in with root user through telnet protocol. It is not allowed. It is allowed here because it is secure. But if suppose you don't want root user to allow, then you can remove this hash from here and configure no. And this will do what? It will not allow the root user. Let's do this. I will remove this hash from here, and I will say I don't want root user to log in. So I will say no here. Permit root login? No. The other options are restrict mode, like needs the password, maximum authentication try is 6. That means you can try 6 wrong passwords. After that, the account will be locked. Session is 10. So continuous simultaneously, it supports 10 seconds. Public key authentication here, the public authentication is yes. Then there is an option here, authorized key file. This is to have an authorized key file. Now this will allow you to use the key-based authentication. I will show you what is key-based authentication. But when you use the key-based authentication, that this is the file name for the key-based authentication we use. Now if you want to change, then you can change the name from here. Then we have option here says password authentication yes. That means when you want to authenticate through the SSH, then you have to provide the password. If you say no, then it will do without authentication, without password. The authentication will be done without password. Also you can do permit empty passwords also. Password authentication yes, you can disable it by using no here. What we change here is only that we have disallowed the root user. So there are multiple configurations are there which we can change for our SSH configuration. I have changed only one thing, and that is what? I have disallowed the root user. Now I will save the file, and I want this settings to be updated. So I don't restart the whole server, I will only restart the service, that is SSHD, which is responsible for handling this SSH service. And my configurations are applied. Now we'll try to log in again from Linux 2 and try to use the root account. So this is Linux 2. Now I will again try to use SSH with root account. I'm not mentioning any user account, so it will go for root. It is asking for the password. I will say this is my password of root user account. and it says permission denied, please try again. So it is not allowing me to log in as a root user. Root users are not allowed. Only normal users can be logged in. Root users are not allowed because we have disabled the root user. I will press cancel. Now I will try to log in as a normal user. User 2. Password. And it is allowed. Now there is one more problem, one more security problem you will face, and that is a Trojan, that is called Trojans. Trojans, what? It is a hidden software which steals the information. In the Trojans, they have key loggers also. Those key loggers do what? When you type any key from your system in a command or any file, what it do? It logs all the keys, and then the log of those keys it will send to the hacker. So hacker can know that what you do. Like, we have disabled the root, but if suppose the root was enabled, so if I try to log in with this, so first when I type this SSH and the IP address, it will be logged. It will be logged and it is hidden. We don't know that it is logging. And then it will, when I password, when I give the password, it will also log. Now even it is not connecting, but it's still the logging is there, so password will be logged. So that is why the root account is not allowed. Then if I try to log in as a normal user also, then also the hacker can get my password and username because the key logging is there. Now for that, for saving this, what we can do? We can enable the key-based authentication. Key-based authentication, that means instead of providing the password, we generate the key here, our public key here, and then send the public key to the server. And it will store on the server by using that name, with the name which we saw in the configuration file. So we send the key, directly the key to the server. Now when we authentication key, now when we try to log in here, so we don't require the password. When you try to log in here, we just give SSH our username and the password, and then it will do what? It will send the key that it will log us without any password. So we can log in without any password, and we can log in without any password by key-based authentication. Now for that, what we have to do? First, we have to generate the key here in this client system, and then we send the key to the server. So first we have to generate the key, and then we have to send the key to the server. And for that, what we will do? We will use the command. SSH key gen. So we use this command to generate the key. This command will do what? It will generate two keys, public and private key. This is for the authentication for the user. So when you run this command, it says yes, this is to generate the key, public and private. Now enter the file in which to save the key. So by default, the keys are going to save under the current users. Current user, because right now I'm logged in as a root user. So current users, home directory, it is going to save into .ssh directory, hidden directory. And the name of the file will be id_RSA. RSA is the algorithm which is used to generate the key. Now I will not change the path. I will go with the default path. Then it says enter the passphrase. Now we can have a passphrase for the key-based authentication. Passphrase, that means we can configure something here which will be used as a password. So when you try to connect with this user, connect the user by using the key-based authentication, then again it will ask this passphrase. Now this passphrase will be different than the password, the normal password of the user. So if any hacker gets the password, they will get only this passphrase. It will not get the real password. But I don't want to set it. I will go blank. Then it says enter again. Because I'm not setting, I will press enter again. I will go blank. And it has generated. So it has generated my fingerprint key with the authentication. So when you check this directory now, that is under root, home directory dot ssh. So you can see there is two key here, id underscore rsa and id underscore rsa dot pub. So this is a private key and this is the public key. Now we have to send this public key to the server, and on the server, when you check the configuration file, it is going to store here under the user's home directory, and with the name, under the user's home directory, there it will create .ssh, and in that it will create this file. The name of the file will be this. This will be the public key which we sent. So the key will be sent, that name is different, but here in this server it will be named as authorized underscore keys. So how we will send the key from the client? So for sending the key from here, we will use ssh copy id command. We will use this command to send the key from here to the server by using the user account, which user account you want to configure as a key based authentication. We will mention hyphen I for the identity file, which is located under root user's home directory, and under that we have id ssa ha rsa, and this is dot pub. So we have to send this file dot pub. Now we are sending the file, so we have to decide which user we want to send the file. So that user will do the key based authentication. So I will send it for user one. Now it is asking the password for the user one. So I will say ABC. And now it is send the key. It has sent the key on user one's home directory, and then when the user one try to connect, now it does not require to provide the password. So it did what? It installed the key there on the server by using this user account. And now what? Now you can try to log in into the machine with using SSH and username, and it will log you without any password. So when you try here SSH now with using the username at this, then you can see it is not asking any password here. Why? Because we are doing the key based authentication, and it is not available for other user. If suppose I try to use it for user 2, so it asks the password here, because we have installed only the key for user 1. We have not installed the key for user 2. So user 2 still needs the password to connect. When we check the server there, and we want to see where the key goes, and we check the root user's home directory, SSH directory, under the root user's home directory. So there is no key here. Actually, the key goes into the user's home directory. That user is user one. Under user one's home directory, we have SSH, and in that you can see the key name authorized underscore keys. That is the name which is configured under the configuration file, and that is not available for user two. And there is no directory, even no directories exist there for user 2. So user 2 can't do the key based authentication, only user 1 can do. Now what we can do, we can make more secure our system, our SSH. We have disabled the root login, then we can also do what? We can disable the password login. We can disable the password login only the users which is having the key based authentication. Only those users can log in, and the other users which they don't have the key login, they will not be able to do the login. We can do that by going into the configuration file, and we can disable the password login. We saw the option was there. It says password authentication yes. So we'll configure it no. then nobody can log in by using the password. Now this option says password authentication yes. I will change it to no. Now there is no option, nobody can log in without with password. Now what I will do, I will reboot the service, restart the service. Now nobody can log in with the password, only users with have a key based authentication can log in. This will make our system a secure system. Let's try this now from Linux 2. Now from Linux 2, user 2 was still logging. Now I will try to log in again with user 2 now. It says you can't log in, permission deny. You have to log in with key, public key. That means key based authentication. Now user 1 try and it can still log in. So only the users which have the pre-authentication key, then they can only log in, and the users which don't have, they try to use the password to log in, they can't because we have disabled it. So this is how we can do what? We can secure the SSH connection by disabling the root user, disabling the password authentication, only enable the key-based authentication. So we can save from man-in-the-middle attack, we can also save from the keyloggers, trojans, all that. So that was the SSH configuration. Now SSH comes with the OpenSSH toolkit. It comes with the different tools. One of the tool is SCP. This SCP also uses the SSH secure tunnel. Actually, SSH do what? It creates the secure encrypted tunnel to send the data from client to server. This SCP also uses the same secure tunnel secured by the SSH keys to send the data from one server to other server. It is actually the copy. It is used to copy the file from network. So we can copy the file from this server to other server by using the SCP, secure copy. Normal, we use copy, and this is what secure copy. Now, for example, we have some files here. We have this file here, and I want to send this file to the Linux 2 system. Now remember, SSH is available in both the sites, so we can do the communication from here to there also. Now for example, if I try to connect from here to server 2, so I can do that also. And again, it is sending the key because we are doing first time. So now both servers knows each other, they both have the keys, so we can do what? SCP also. Now we have this file here. I want to send it to the destination server. So I will use SCP. Then I will mention the file which we have in this local directory. And then I will mention the network path. As a destination, I will mention the network path, that is 19.2. And on that, I want to send it to root home directory. So when I press enter here, it asks me the password of this remote server, root user. ABC. Now when I provide the password, it transfers the file. It says the file is transferred securely, 100% successfully. Now the file is transferred, but the benefit of using SCP is that the file transferred securely. Securely by using the SSH key, SSH tunnel, SSH encryption tunnel. Now we can go and check on Linux 2, the file is there. And under the Linux 2, we have sent the file under root user's home directory, so we can check it is available here. We can also do what? We can also pull the file from this machine to that machine. For example, I will create one file here. Let's say I will create Linux 2 file here, linux2.txt. This is the file. Now I want to get this file on the other server, Linux 1. So I can do that by just getting the file from here to the other server. So to get the file from other machine, I will still use SCP. Now for source, I will mention the network path from 2, and I want to get the file from root user's home directory. I know the file name is linux2.txt. And then I want to get the file under my root home user home directory. Now it is asking again the password. So I will provide the password and file transfer successfully. And we can see the file is here. So this is also a tool which we can use. This is also a tool which is a part of OpenSSH. Then the other tools are also there, like we can use the SFTP, which can give us the secure FTP connection from the client to FTP server by using the same SSH tunnel. SSH, secure SSH tunnel. So these are the networking tools, some of the networking tools we have, and also we have, we know how we can configure the SSH. So we saw how we can configure the SSH, how we can configure and secure our SSH server.